It's rather important in this life to finally figure out what makes you happy. I happen to like good books, old movies, music of almost any kind. When Notre Dame is playing an Irish with a game, that makes me happy. I love the Diocese of Peoria. All these realities I count as blessings because they make me a happy man. But of course, there is a much deeper bliss that is the source for all true happiness, all the happiness you and I could never know. The foundation of all blessing is, of course, the experience of God. As human beings, we are, by design, hardwired for God. We have a kind of God-shaped vacuum in our hearts and in our minds. We have a hole in the soul that even the entire universe could not fill. How did St. Augustine once phrase it? Our hearts are restless until they rest in you, my God. God made us for himself, and his love is behind all the other loves that we may ever be blessed to know. We were created and redeemed for beatitude, for the boundless bliss of God's great love. The entire moral code of Christianity has been given to us by God to prepare us for this bliss. So if we want to be happy, if we want to be blessed in this world, we must love God first and then freely love one another. This is the secret of all human happiness, but since it's been announced for nearly 20 centuries, it shouldn't be a secret. Today's appointed gospel reading, according to Luke, gives us the heart of the good news. Now, Matthew's version of the narrative can be found in his Sermon on the Mount. But in Luke, the gospel we heard today, Jesus gives this teaching not in the mount, but rather on a plain, or what the gospel describes as a level stretch of land, where a large crowd all Judea, Jerusalem, and even from the pagan regions of Tyre and Sidon. Jesus uses this great parable to give the people his new law, his new Torah, his proclamation of the gospel. In Matthew, there are eight beatitudes, but in Luke, only four. These four are also coupled with four woes, or curses, directed against those who reject the beatitudes. Both Matthew and Luke do, however, agree completely about the fundamental message. The New Testament word for beatitude is makarios. It means blessed. It means happy. It means fortunate. It can even mean lucky. How happy and fortunate are those who depend upon God in their lives. The Beatitudes are blessings because they praise God for his goodness to his little ones in the future. Happy are those who are willing to depend not on their own strength, but rather depend entirely upon a relationship with God. Jesus himself is the model for this beatitude. From the poverty of the cradle to the self-giving of the cross, Jesus trusted completely in the goodness of his Father. He teaches all those who follow him to have the same kind of dependence on the Father for anything good and blessed in this world or the world to come. We Christians, we disciples, are supposed to be poor in spirit so that God can enrich us with blessing. We are called to be hungry for God so God can fill us up with his love and mercy. As disciples, we are asked to notice the pain of other people. We are even invited, this is a tough one, to rejoice even when this world hates us and persecutes us because we are faithful to Jesus. The Lord promises that we will reward our love, just as God gave glory to the prophets of old. But God, who is perfect justice, will also punish with woe those who reject his gift of grace. Or perhaps a better way of putting it is that those who reject the attitude, who build their lives on isolation from God, are punishing themselves. Listen again to the words of the prophet Jeremiah, today's first reading. They almost foretell the words of the gospel. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose hope is in the Lord. He is like a tree planted beside the waters. He fears not the heat. When it comes, its leaves stay green. In the year of drought, he shows no distress, but still bears fruit. And like the evangelist Luke, the prophet goes on to them, woe to those who trust in the who seek their strength in life, whose hearts turn away from the Lord. Our decisions in this life have consequences, and God does not impose his blessings. We are always confronted with challenging choices. Whenever we hear the scriptures read to us, or when we read, do we want to build our lives around blessing, around the attitude of trusting God, or do we want to depend on our selfishness, our personal determination to do what everybody else in this world is doing, and be praised for it? As Christians, we say we depend upon the cross and resurrection of Jesus, not upon praise and approbation of our neighbors. Paul teaches in today's second reading, Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first fruits of all those who have fallen asleep. As believers, the Lord's victory over sin and death should change everything about us. This is infinite blessing and happiness. But there is endless sadness with those who reject the good news. So at this Mass, as we gather together in praise and God for his blessing, let us resolve to try a bit harder to be a blessing to one another. If we want God to love us, to forgive us, to console us, we too should be willing to love, to forgive, and console one another, and do whatever we can to help those in trouble. Doing good is a blessing in itself. It makes us happy. If we want to receive all the blessings of the Most Holy Eucharist, we should try to live in the blessings of the Gospel of Love. We who are fed and satisfied by that bread that has come down from heaven need to begin to live the life of them right now, even here on earth. Jesus Christ is truly the Lord of bliss. He heals and restores all. words. Doing good is a blessing for ourselves. Fed by the Lord, we can simply accomplish miracles. Led by Him, we can live in the attitude and avoid the woes. After all, think about it. Who or what is more wonderful than God? What is finally more pleasing than doing God's will? What desire is more urgent than our hunger for God? God's goodness simply knows no limits. So if we want to be happy, may we be filled with the attitude.